Over the last number of weeks, we've been talking about why are we here? Anybody remember why we're here? You get out of the house on Sunday mornings, right? Give us something to get up for. Why is it that we gather together Sunday mornings or as a congregation?
To be encouraged.
That was the first reason that we gathered together, remember? I asked you a specific question over the last couple of weeks. Do you guys remember that question? It was, are you saved and satisfied, or are you saved and sanctified? And the idea there is, are you happy with your Christian walk the way it is? Or do you think it needs some improvement? How many think that their Christian walk could use some improvement? Excellent. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the number one reason, the first reason we gathered together, and that was to be equipped, to be built up, to do the work of ministry. This is where we get our equipment and our abilities to step out and go and do the work of ministry. We also talked that the second reason, or one of the reasons that we gather, was to encounter Jesus. Because if we don't encounter Jesus in what we're doing, there's no reason to do it. There's no reason to do the work of ministry if Jesus is not involved in it. It's not lasting. And that brings us to the third reason that we gather. We gather together so we can leave again. Sounds kind of silly, doesn't it? We gather together so that we can go out. And it's just like what LaVon was singing in the song and talking about with the disciples. Right? They gathered together, they saw the feeding of the 5,000, they got into the boat, they headed out to sea, and the storm scared them. And they gathered together with Jesus and got built up. But all of that reason was so that they could go. Remember, Jesus got them into the boat and said, go over there. They had a purpose. And we have a purpose. That is why God created His church. So that we can go out and share the good news. The news of what Jesus has done for us. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles to Mark chapter 16. And we're going to look at two verses. This is the very end of the Gospel of Mark. The last chapter in it. And towards the end of the chapter, Jesus tells us. Mark records, He said to them, that is Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. And whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. This section of text is known as the Great Commission. And whenever we hear the words, the Great Commission, we all automatically go to the Gospel of Matthew, where Matthew tells us, or Matthew records the words of Jesus where he says, go and make disciples. We all know that, right? We've all heard that verse a million times. But did you realize that there are actually at least 28 different verses proclaiming for us to go out and make disciples? 28 different ways the scriptures tell us to go and share the gospel message. Like LaVon had said, how many verses are there on do not fear? There's 400. Over one a day you can read and still be uplifted, right? Do not fear. God's trying to tell us something. Same thing with going and sharing the gospel message. He says, do not fear. He says, go and make disciples, or some form of there about getting up and getting out and sharing the gospel message, the good news of Jesus. 28 different times that I counted. You remember when Jesus had his disciples together, and he wasn't talking just the 12, by the way, when we talk about the disciples here. Jesus had all of his followers together, and he asked them, who do you say that I am? You guys remember that when Jesus was talking to them? Go ahead and nod your heads yes so that I know that you're at least tracking with me there. So. Matthew tells us that when he asked this question, they were in the region of Caesarea Philippi. And we read that text, and we say, okay, yay, great. They were out on a little field trip or whatever, wherever Caesarea Philippi is, and God is asking them this question, and they think this is great. But we have to kind of put this into context. We have to understand what's really going on there. In first century Israel, Caesarea Philippi would be what we would call Sin City. It was probably the most immoral place in all the known world. And Jesus went there with his followers. It was completely reviled by all Orthodox rabbis. And it was taught that no good Jew would ever visit there. He's got my number, doesn't he? So here we have Jesus going to visit this location that no good Jew would ever go to, probably the most immoral place in all the known world, and Jesus goes there. Now, one reason why that this was so bad is because of all of the shrines and all of the pagan worship going on there. One area, right outside the city gates, was a shrine area and a cave called the Gates of Hades. Now, it was called the Gates of Hades because they felt that Baal would come and go to the world, to the underworld, through this cave. They used to do human sacrifices into this cave. They'd drag babies in and throw them into this big pit that was right inside the cave. It was a horrendously terrible place. And we don't know for sure exactly where Jesus was in this region because it was the whole city area, but the idea is, from almost every scholar, is that they must have been standing within sight of the cave because of what Jesus said. If you remember, he tells us in Matthew chapter 16, when Peter makes his confession, when Jesus says, "Well, who do the people say I am?" And Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says to him, "I tell you, Peter, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not prevail against it." Right? We read that text and we think, okay, God says, okay, I'm going to build this church, right? We think of a building, and the gates of Hades, hole in the ground and the spawn of hell, if you will, coming up out of this hole and attacking the church, right? That's the picture we get, isn't it? Do we not? Sorry, he's just looking at me. But that's the idea, right? We get this idea that God's building this church, Stillwater Lutheran Church, out here in the West Valley, and the very gates of hell, the spawn of Satan, are surrounding it and attacking it. And while that's not necessarily a bad picture or a wrong picture, that is not the picture that Jesus is giving in this text. We often think that Jesus is giving some kind of defensive position here, right? We build the churches and the fight against the world, and Satan himself comes from behind, and they're out here and they're attacking us, and we're standing there and we know that God will stand for us and our gates will hold. He's not talking about the gates of the church, is he? He says the gates of hell itself. What he's talking about is we will attack Satan. He is giving an offensive command here about the gates of hell, about the work of God and the work of Satan in the world. He says, I'm building my church. What's the church? Is it really the building? Of course, we know it's not. Look around. You are the church. And you are called to go out, leave this building, because we do gather for a purpose, right? We gather to be equipped. We gather to encounter Jesus. But now we must go to fight the good fight, to fight the battle that is laid before us. It's called the Great Commission. God has commissioned us to go and make disciples. Unfortunately, it's often the great omission in our lives. See, the purpose on this earth is not to build a name for ourselves. Because who's going to remember you in 100 years? The purpose is not to amass a fortune. How much can you spend in your lifetime? It's not to have a large family, and there's nothing wrong with any of those, but that's not our purpose. God did not leave us on the earth after he saved us just to occupy a pew and maybe drop a dollar in the plate every week. That's not the purpose. The church's goal is more than filling a building. The church's goal is about going and spreading the gospel message. You guys remember what our mission statement is? Let's say it loud. Sharing Jesus Christ with our neighbors. That's the church's goal. That's Stillwater Lutheran Church's goal. That is the Church of Christ's goal. And while it's all great, we want to see the church filled, and we want to have that kind of idea, the real purpose is to build the kingdom. Because if we build the kingdom, God will take care of the church. This particular church. So if we focus on that, then God can take care of the rest. And yet, how often have you thought, well, that's just not my thing? How often have you thought, well, that's not my gift, I'm not an evangelist? Or, I can't do that. That's just not within my capability. We all think something like that at one time or another, some of us more often than not. And yet, the commission still stands there. Jesus talking to his disciples, his followers, the Christians of the day, if you will, saying, go and make disciples. Go and proclaim the message. We sometimes get confused about why or what or any kind of that. When LaVon was talking about the message, we say, well, I can't share the gospel because I haven't memorized it. St. Francis of Assisi used to say, and he's credited with saying, preach the gospel. Use words if necessary. Your life, it needs to reflect Christ in what you do. That's how you preach it. So, for today, you guys have heard the saying, mind your P's and Q's, right? Old saying about remembering your pleases and thank yous and stuff like that. Today I'm going to have you remember the M&Ms of evangelism. Why is it that we are going out and sharing the word? So the M&Ms of evangelism, and there's 7 M's, if you will. The first M is remembering the man. Our commission comes directly from the man himself, Jesus. We know he has the authority, doesn't he tell us, all authority on heaven and earth has been given unto me? So the man himself has commissioned us to go out. God himself has said, you, each and every one of you, are to go out, and it doesn't matter how old you are, it doesn't matter what you do, it doesn't matter any of that. We all can share the gospel message in some form or another. I read a sermon last week that gave the attributes of God from A to Z. It had 26 different attributes going down from A to Z. The only thing that I really remembered out of it was the all-encompassing, our God is amazing and he is zealous for all to come to know him. That's what we need to hold to us, that God is zealous. Do you realize that you are commissioned by the man himself? Second M is the mandate. God says, go. I absolutely love the fact, and I didn't even check with LaVon on this, but she tied this the disciples taking the boat and going across the river. Go! And they did it! They were probably tired and probably grumpy about the idea. I mean, like LaVon said, they just got through feeding 5,000 people and collecting baskets of food and all of the stuff going on, And Jesus said, okay, now go. And they're thinking, oh, great, more work. Because now they got to row across the lake. And in the middle of the night, we know that the storm came up, and they're rowing, and they're going, really, God, this is what you gave me to do? Really, I cannot believe this. Right? And then they see a ghost. And they're afraid, and they're tired, and they're grumpy. And Jesus comes in and says, do not fear. And everything settles down, and now they're like, oh, okay. That's our call. Each and every one of us are called to step out. Get out of your comfort zone and go. We must leave these four walls. Now, we don't have to go to deepest, darkest Africa or down to South America. You don't have necessarily are called to be a missionary somewhere, but you are called to be a missionary here. You just need to go. So go to work. When you go home, when you go to school, when you go to the store, when you go, share the gospel message by what you do. The third M becomes the missionary. Sometimes the translation says just go into the world. Some of the translations say go ye into the world. It is a personal command. When you read the original text, Jesus is telling each individual person, you must go into the whole world. You see, God is just looking for a few good men. And it's not the Marine Corps, by the way. And women, by the way, in this case. Ezekiel chapter 22 says exactly that. God is asking, I am just looking for a few good men who will go. In Isaiah, when Isaiah is standing before the throne room, and I read that text, he's standing before the throne room and God himself says, who will go for me? And Isaiah says, I will go. But you remember why he says I will go is because God has just cleansed him from all unrighteousness. You have been cleansed from all unrighteousness. And now you get to go and share that with others. That brings us to the fourth M, the mission field. What is the mission field? In your life, what is the mission field? It is the all the world, but it starts with the area right around you. Do your neighbors know Jesus? If you don't know, I have to ask you, why don't you know? Do the people you work with know Jesus? If you're around them, you can ask them. Bring it up in a conversation. Nobody's going to throw anything at you. That brings us to the fifth M, which is the mission itself. To preach. I think that one word scares more people than anything else. Well, maybe except the word evangelism. When we think about preaching, we think, oh, we've got to stand in the pulpit and give the message. And that's not what that word means. The word literally means to proclaim, to tell. You proclaim and tell the good news by the things that you do, by the things, the people that you meet, how they meet you when they talk to you. And by the way, there are multitude of messages to go out and preach or proclaim. Preach and proclaim the good news, the kingdom of God. Paul says, preach the word. And he says, be ready in season and out of season. And then he talks a little bit about that, but he says, because a time will come when they, the unbelievers, will not endure sound doctrine, but will look for teachers who will tell them whatever they want to hear. Don't we see that in our lives today? And it is our job, our responsibility, our calling to preach the word. You say, well, wait a minute. How about this? You can't make somebody believe, but you can definitely tell them. And that brings us to what is it you tell them? What message do you share? The gospel message. How many of you know what gospel stands for? What the gospel means, what the word gospel literally means. Good news. It means good news. We proclaim, tell others, the good news. The good news that Jesus died to save us from our sins. Do you believe that? Again, everybody nod your head, yes. And sometimes, I think in our lives, we either don't believe the power of the gospel message, we don't believe that it will change lives, or if we do believe that, then we want to limit the number of people we're going to let into heaven. Because we don't want to share that with others. You guys ever hear of Fritz Kreisler? He was a world-famous violinist, died back in 1962. He earned a fortune with his concerts and compositions. They didn't even calculate how much they estimated he earned. And he died poor because he generously gave most of it away. He received money in and he gave it right back away. But one day when he was out and about, he discovered this exquisite violin, but he didn't have any money to buy it. And it was in a shop and it was just sitting there. So he really wanted this violin. It was like one of the top violins ever made. So later, he raised enough money to purchase it. He went back in to go buy it, but the seller had already gotten rid of it. He sold it to a collector. But the guy that sold it gave them the collector's name, so Kreisler went to the collector's house and talked to him about this violin. And the collector said it had become one of his most prized possessions and he wasn't going to sell it. And it was sitting in this case in his collection of different stuff. So Kreisler asked if he could play the instrument one time before this collector consigned the instrument to silence. That was what the words that he used. So the collector said, sure, why not? He knew who Kreisler was, that he was this world-famous violinist. So he handed him the violin. And Kreisler played such a heart-moving piece that this collector just said, I have no right to keep that to myself. It's yours. Take it to the world and let the people hear it. Mm-hmm. That's the gospel message. You see, we get this gospel message and we hold it. Praise God for that. We've got it. We've been saved. And then we want to keep it as a collector's item. But we need to be more like Kreisler. Play that gospel message to everybody around us. Share it. Let people hear it. Because God gives it to us to share. And that brings us to the final M that we want to look at, the ministry. Jesus said, preach the gospel message to every creature, is how Mark says it. And I want to point out, we look at this text and we think about this and we think, wow, what a daunting task. God has called us to preach the message, and we look at all the world around us or all the creatures or all the people, however the text says it, we start to think, how can I ever do this? But in almost every single solitary proclamation about sharing the gospel, in all the instructions, God gives us a definite progression. Jesus tells us in Acts, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And if you look at a map, it's Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, all the end of the earth. Jesus is not asking you to go into all the world tomorrow and preach the gospel. He's asking you to step outside these walls and share the gospel message. Starting at home. And sometimes we think, well, people just aren't going to listen to the message. They're not going to listen. But almost everybody is seeking answers, aren't they? Almost everybody is asking questions. And this is an opportunity to give some answers to some of those questions. You think about what happened to Philip in the Gospel, or in Acts. Remember, Philip was whisked away and all of a sudden he met the eunuch. Here's a guy he didn't have any clue on, but he saw that he was reading the scriptures. So Philip said, hey, let me go. Do you understand what you're reading? Let me share it with you. And the eunuch says, well, how can I possibly know this? And of course, he showed him, shared the gospel, and the eunuch came to salvation. And we know that this eunuch was high up in the court of Sheba. And we know that a church was started because that one person shared the gospel message. So think about this on our scale. You look around. If each of us shared the gospel with one person, how many people are we just shared with? And if they share the gospel with just one person, think of the multiplication. You realize the strongest argument for the gospel of Christ is your personal testimony. Is for somebody to see your life changed by Christ. And you don't have to be this, it doesn't have to be this super drastic, absolute, you know, who was the guy that wrote the song Amazing Grace? Do you guys remember that? I can't remember his name.
John something.
Yeah, on his tombstone he says, you know, I was a brigadier, I was a slave trader, I was all these different things, but then I was saved by grace. And he changed his life. And our lives don't have to be that drastic. They are, really, no matter where we come from, but we don't sometimes see that. You know, there was a guy by the name of Charles Bradlaugh who was an avowed atheist. And he challenged Reverend Hughes, H.P. Hughes, to a debate. This was back in England. And the preacher Hughes led a rescue mission in London. And he accepted this debate with this avowed atheist, this guy who was like, I mean, he was crushing Christians all around with his arguments on Darwinism and so on and so forth. And so this little preacher, country preacher from this rescue mission, was challenged to a debate. And Hughes said, yeah, I'll take the debate. But, he goes, under one condition. I want to bring with me 100 people, men and women, who will tell what happened in their lives since trusting Christ as their Savior. They were people who were living in sin, but now have come to the cross. They were poverty-stricken homes with vices from their parents and all of these issues, but now their lives are changed. And he says, you can cross-examine them, you can ask them questions, you can check and see whether or not their lives have indeed changed. And he says, and furthermore, you can bring 100 non-believers and you can tell us how their lives have been affected by their lack of faith, and we'll hold them side by side. So the day of the debate shows up, and Hughes is there with his 100 men and women whose lives have been changed by Christ, and they're waiting and waiting and waiting, and Bradlaugh never showed up. This world-renowned infidel, atheist, refused to show up. And it was really rather interesting because the result was that it became a testimony time for all of these people to hear how God had changed their lives. And that's what sharing the gospel message is all about. Just telling people how God has changed your life. 7 M's of ministry. 7 M's of evangelism. And it's not difficult. But we are called to go out. So we gather together to be equipped. We gather together to encounter Jesus, and then we gather together to leave again and share the gospel message. Let's pray.